Hi, this is Steve Horvath coming to you from the Expo. I've got a real treat for you. I've got basically what I look as a natural, as a national treasure here in the great Lefty Cray. Lefty, you've probably done just about everything there is to do in fishing in North America and a lot of other places.
Yeah, I've been a lot of places.
Yeah, and you're credited with a lot of things in fishing and a lot of innovations, and I believe you have a new rod that you wanted to talk about.
Well, Temple Fork Outfitters has a new rod out. It's extremely light, extremely strong, and where most of these rods cost $600-$800, ours cost $250, and a lot of the light rods have some problems, but we've not had any problem with ours on breakage. In fact, the 8-weight rod, Steve, we've been catching. I haven't, but some of my friends have been catching albacore, which are like little tuna.
Absolutely.
Up to about 16 pounds on an 8-weight rod. Mm-hmm. And we've actually had them try to break the rod on a fish, and they haven't been able to. And we've designed them so that the tips have a great deal of trouble breaking a 5X tippet, the trout tippets. So we're real happy about that. The other thing you ask about any observations in the fly fishing field. One of the things I've been encouraged the last 2 or 3 years is the number of women that are coming into the sport. And I do private lessons at home in Maryland. And quite often when if a woman came for a fly casting lesson, the man usually brought her. But now what happens is the men are being brought by the women, which is very unusual. Or I have several women at a time. And I even have, last year and this year, I have a all-women's class. And I can teach any woman I ain't married to. The one I'm married to for 64 years, I'm happily married because I don't try to teach her.
There you go.
Wives don't listen to what we say, they listen to how we say.
Absolutely.
But women are very good listeners. And the fact that they haven't seen a lot of videos or had prior instruction, they learn extremely fast. I had two girls today here at the show that were throwing 35, 40 feet of line with a 2-foot loop, no trouble at all, in a matter of 4 or 5 minutes. So I'm real encouraged by that part of the session.
Yeah, that's something. Some of my greatest feats in fly fishing have been just staying out of trees.
Yeah, I think we could all say that.
Exactly. Yeah. And, you know, it's a good point you bring up about women and fishing. The women that I've taken fishing on some of my trips, I do a lot of Back Bay flounder trips and stuff like that. They literally embarrass their boyfriends and husbands by the amount of fish they catch.
Well, what's really interesting to me is for many years, Frontiers International's probably the biggest fishing travel agency in the world. They're in Wexford, Pennsylvania. And I used to take groups for them all over the world. We went to Christmas Island, New Guinea, all kinds of places. And almost invariably, Steve, if there was a woman on the trip, she would either catch the biggest fish or almost the biggest fish. And a lot of times, her boyfriend or her husband, it was a bitter pill to swallow, but a lot of them really got a kick out of it. The good thing was they didn't think much of it. That was one of their first fish, and it was one of the largest fish. In fact, there was, probably 30 years ago, I did a thing on world records by women at IGFA. This was offshore stuff, and it was astounding how many of those women, it was the first fish they ever caught. It was a world record. They have an affinity for just seeming to be able. I think it's their laid-back attitude is a lot of it.
Right. They fish without an ego.
That's right.
You know, a lot of fishermen are, and I can speak for myself at times, legends in their own minds. And a lot of times somebody comes into it with just the right personality and the right outlook on it, and they outfish us like crazy.
Yep, yep.
And, people like yourself, Stu Apt and some other guys that really laid the groundwork for my generation are really out there. I almost want to call it preaching, you know, what to really do and what to listen. What do you see in the new generation of fly fishing people out there?
Well, I think that it's very encouraging. I would like to see more young people coming into it. the best thing about the fly fishing industry itself is that for many years, it was a very costly sport to get into. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you, for example, if you had two boys and you wanted to get into, introduced into fly fishing 20 years, 15 years ago even, the cheapest rod was several hundred dollars. The cheapest order reels were close to $500. It was close to $1,000 just to get two boys, and you didn't know whether they were going to like it or not. So a lot of people never bothered. Now you can go to Bass Pro or Cabela's or lots of tackle stores and get a combination outfit that you and I could fish very comfortably with. And I think almost any fly rod today that you buy that costs more than $100 casts better than the guy that bought it.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. And then saltwater reels now, there are lots of reels from a little under 100 to a little over, just under 200 to a little over 200 that will do. I helped to develop, me and Flip Powell and Ted Jurczyk developed the T-Bore fly reel, which is considered one of the finest reels ever made. The actual performance difference between them and some of these $200 reels, which are one-third the cost of those, is no difference. They do have a nicer finish. It's a prettier reel and that sort of thing. But so now we have tackle that anybody can afford, and I wish we'd have had this for a long time.
Right. I kind of equate it a lot of times to you could put me in a Cessna or a 747, and I'm going to crash that plane just the same because I can't fly, you know. And just let's talk about entry-level stuff. If a person was going to get into fly fishing and they were going to go to their local pond or stream, catch some sunfish, learn how to cast, what weight rod and what type of line do you think you would set them up with?
Actually, for all fly fishing, you only need a couple rods.
Mm-hmm.
If you had somewhere between a weight forward 4 to 6 weight rod, which those light lines,
mm-hmm.
you can do any kind of bluegill brim fishing. You can do trout fishing, that sort of thing. And if you got an 8 or an or 9, you can do an Atlantic salmon, you can do bass bugging, you can do almost all your inshore mm-hmm. saltwater fishing. And then if you got a 9 or a 10, you could do most everything you do, including almost a well-designed 10 would even land very large tarpon. So for 3 rod sizes, you could really go. No fly fishing would stand for that. But
right.
but you really don't need that any more than that, really.
Right, and being a bass fisherman myself, a guy with 25, 26 rods, I look at that. And my father's really big into fly fishing. He does a lot of saltwater fly fishing and stuff. And his deal is standing on the bulkheads at night, catching stripers in the rivers and the inlets, and that's his deal.
Right.
And it boggles my mind that although the mechanics of fly fishing can be very hard to get, especially for me because I'm always into bigger, harder, stronger is better, a person that could be 3 foot tall could cast as far as I can very easily with the right mechanics. Fly fishing is probably the simplest yet hardest form of fishing to do.
It is in some situations. It's like all tackle. I don't just fish fly tackle. I use all tackle.
Sure.
There are places where fly fishing is much more advantageous to use. If you got very calm water, you got bluefish laying up on the surface, or you got bonefish on a shallow flat, a fly rod is going to definitely catch a lot more fish. If you got a wind howling out there and they're chopping the waves, you ought to put the fly rod away and go to spinning or even a plug tackle.
Right.
And then, of course, if you really got to get below about 15, 18 feet, you can do it with fly fishing tackle, but other tackle is so much easier to do it with. So it's kind of foolish just to use one type of tackle.
Right. Now, I've got one question for you, and it's a fly fishing question, and tell me if I'm cheating when I do this. Okay, all my friends, when we go fly fishing and stuff, we'll go down the shore, and everybody will fish a clouser minnow and stuff like that. But I take that same hook with the barbell eyes, and I thread a 4-inch twister worm on it. Am I still fly fishing, or am I cheating?
You're not fly fishing. The reason...
I can't argue with Lefty Craig.
Well, the reason is that the general accepted definition of fly fishing is that you... have to make repetitively false casts without obvious problems with either you
or the
equipment.
And that worm adds a lot of weight.
Well, the worm would come off on a false cast.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. That ain't fly fishing.
Okay, folks. You heard it from Lefty. I'm a cheater. But I do catch them like that. You know I catch them like that.
You probably caught them better with spinning like that.
You're right. But I got to tell somebody I caught a fish on a fly.
All right.
Lefty, I want to thank you very much for coming. It's been my honor. This is Steve Horvath for Delaware Valley Outdoors from the Sports Show. Signing off. Come out and see us.